R.B. Baskren graduated from the Madras School of Arts and Crafts in 1966. This was a time when different schools of modern Indian art were emerging from the shadows of Western art.
He was part of the defining moment of what became known as the Madras Art Movement, along with K.C.S. Panicker and S. Dhanapal. Baskren, like other artists at this time, employed Indian motifs in his early works, but he later rejected this deliberate nativism and referred to his artistic production of the 1960s as pseudo-Indian.
Baskren returned to the Madras School of Arts and Crafts in 1969, this time not as a student, but as a teacher of note. During his career there, he left an indelible impression upon many of his students, some of whom are names to be reckoned with in the national art scene today. Douglas, Palaniappan, Murali Taran, Valsan Kaleri, Ravi Shankar, Vasudha, and Trotsky Marutu. Ever since, Baskren has been developing his own very personal vocabulary of still life painting. Whatever be the motifs of his paintings, their underlying theme is always the same: man, woman, and procreation. Baskren rejects intellectualism in art. For him, the various isms are lazy catch-alls for artists who refuse to paint with their hearts.
Aspirant students were involved in a movement, and that was the biggest challenge for all of us at that time. So everyone had this target to say, now I must do something different from the other. So that is why they were all searching in for the self, and that's how the movement began. As part of the movement, there was an approach towards Indianness in Indian modern art. So the whole batches, specifically to say Redappa Naidu and Vishwanathan and some of my colleagues, have entered into presenting symbolism into art. Panicker himself has taken a series called Worlds and Symbols. Apart from his earlier figuration, he has entered into symbolism as an art direction that he took. At the same time, the students were also looking at doing symbolism, using mostly the Hindu symbols like the trident, linga, the snake, and everything connected to the mythology of Hindu mythology to say that this is Indian. When I had the opportunity of traveling into European museums, came back in 1969, I was into teaching at the art school, the same art school where I studied. So as a teacher also, I thought what is this Indianness into Indian art? There was a big question. Does a painting look Indian because of its presentation with symbols and images of the native country? Or is it the person who makes it as an artist from wherever he comes? So I had an argument, then I disagreed with the concept of Indianness into Indian art. I have become global in my thinking and I have entered into a series called Life Cycle. No matter whether you are an Indian or an American or an European or an Asian, there is one life and death in each of the gods making a tree, an insect, or a human being. There is a birth and there is an obvious death and an end. And the end again begins. That is the series which I did called The Life Cycle, where I portrayed a lot of them in lino cuts and drawings, where I portrayed the birth of a child, the perambulator as a symbol of childhood, then the withering of trees, the hills, nature, then ultimately the skull, then again a plant that grows from the seed. So this was a combination to present the birth and death in the Life Cycle series, in which I've never looked whether it is in the Indian constitution or within the Indian geographical design, or it's an universal design. This is obviously an international phenomenon that you cannot make any other argument on this aspect of birth and death. So that was one series.
Bhaskaran is one of those thinking artists. He moved away from what K.C.S. Panikkar was basically proselytizing on nativism.
R.P. Bhaskaran is today one of India's most renowned artists, and I was fortunate enough to have been a student of his. R.P. Bhaskaran, when I was in college, was the head of the graphics department, and he had this uncanny knack of zeroing in on a person's talent or an area on which one could develop one's work. So he had this third eye of zeroing in on an area, a line, a movement which could carry an artist forward to the next level. And for this, I am extremely grateful. Another thing I really appreciated about Mr. Bhaskaran as an artist and as a teacher was that he never expected his students to follow his style of work. He expected each of us to develop a distinct personality and the way we express that personality in a visual medium. Bhaskaran is known as the cat man most predominantly. His cat series is one of the most powerful line I have seen. The sheer stroke of a few lines puts together the muscle, the movement of the cat, the mood of the cat.
The cat series, which has become very popular. I started this as a classroom study before my students. And I wanted to say that you can choose and pick anything that is around you in order to enter into an argument of creating paintings. So I studied the cats for 2 weeks, and the third week onwards I started painting them. Not painting them as cats, but an expression derived out of these studies that I have made. So it has become always a creative contribution from what you have studied, an interpretation of what the image is meant to you in terms of color, space, then the way you present it. All this becomes a storytelling by itself. So you bring in characters, take out, put them in loud words and sometimes lyrically more soft. All this that happens in a creative artist, whether he is a writer, painter, or any of these creative fields, the grammar is similar to one another. And this is what I have done in my cat series, which has become today a world-recognized contribution of an individual artist, that I have done it. So if I, as R.B. Bhaskaran, have done this series of cats, it is R.B. Bhaskaran, who hails from India, has made it. So it is an entirely different picture today, that I did not paint a picture to make myself as Indian, but eventually when your contribution becomes important, then the artist is recognized as an artist from India. And that is the most important thing which I felt. And many people have asked me, why cats? I said, why not cats? That's all. The answer is very simple. I have assimilated an object, and that object has become my own personal statement, which I make statements at different points of time, at different colors and at different times. And it becomes a work of art by R.B. Bhaskaran.
Because of these basic fundamental questions on Indianness, that he moved away from this aspect and he became what I would call him as a conceptual artist. And he based nearly all of his early works on concepts. Since he is very, very sensitive to his surroundings, especially to his social reality, he found that, you know, he can't be grounded only in this evolution series. So he moves away from that and moves into another theme which he selects, which he finds it within his own environment at home, that is the marriage photos. So he develops on this aspect of the marriage photos, you know, which is such an integral part of every family, not only here in Tamil Nadu but all over the country. And he traveled, as a matter of fact, he took on a scholarship and traveled all over the country and made, you know, a number of these studies of marriage photos and represented them in different ways.
The series which I most love are his studio portraits, or what I call my marriage portraits, which is basically a couple, which is extremely synonymous with the Indian culture of the man-woman just after they get married and they are taken away to the studio to get this portrait, which is photographed and put up in the house, distributed to relatives. There is a certain liveliness and innocence about the bride, the groom himself who's not too sure about what he's getting into. And these portraits have struck a chord deep within me. The portrait that Mr. Bhaskaran has done of his parents, the lithograph that I have seen, is something extremely gracious, with his simplicity of line and flat color that he uses, which is just amazingly so strong. And in a room full of pictures, this portrait of his parents stand out as one amongst a whole lot of pictures. They just stand out. You can't miss it in a room.
When I saw these photographs at various places all over the world, a couple hanging in the drawing room, specially taken from a photograph studio with a wedding dress or with a traditional dress, a man and woman standing tight and looking at the lens, behind them a painted canvas of a curtain and a small flower vase and a table, teapot, floor mat. Now, all these things have become such an unrealistic one, if you ask me. Then I thought this is a good thing to portray, and then I always wanted to choose something that I will assimilate and you know, get it to more and more deeply, so that I make pictures out of these elements. And that is how my marriage photo series started. It was all from the hall drawing room of various people and various places, different costumes. And there is a philosophy behind it, that when you think of a Parsi couple, yes, they become Parsis by the name, and by the costume that they wear and the language they speak. But pictorially, yet the same person is dressed with a Gujarati costume, he or she would look like a Gujarati. So pictorially for us, these are images. Then I thought this is an interesting thing to develop and do something. There was a time when I spotted these young students. I said, yes, you will make it. In certain cases, I said, no, you will not become a painter, you will become a printmaker. They have become good printmakers.
This is the one way he encouraged any students who are really interested in graphics. Another one, also he simultaneously works with the students. That is another key point for the, you know, really the people who are really having, wants to work actually, they can work along with the teachers. It's all, you know, it's a good recollection when I was thinking about my college days actually. He worked with the students and I was remembering I also helped to, you know, make some prints and it's a wonderful experience and working with the teachers. See, when I was in the third year or fourth year, I think fourth year, I happened to see his prints actually first time, and then he returned back from England. He brought wonderful prints. That what it inspired me is it's a mixed media technique actually. It is the lines are so beautiful, and on top he made a lot of pencil lines and intricate lines, and you know, mixed with each other, and it gives a fantastic feel of the surface of image. That is really, it's inspired me a lot actually to my work too. See, many artists, I mean, you know, used to do series of works time to time, but no one thinks about they have to bring all things together actually. But in his case, and in Bhaskaran's case, I mean, he brought everything together as a recent series of work, and it goes very fantastic. I mean, now every elements, whatever he puts, either a cat or a still life or a couples, or it has its own meaning, or also it has its own spacing.
I have introduced figures of my own formations and my own costumes and put them together as a man. Sometimes the man would be totally a person from a deep south, from Tirunelveli or Tanjore, with the old style of having long hair, with a mundu. Then suddenly he falls in love with a foreigner with a long robe. So it's a joy that I play with people. There's no story behind it, but these are images that I play with. While putting them onto frames, I have to look for my grammar of space, my argument of my lines, the colors, and the way I present it. So it becomes totally a nothingness with images that I create to something as a product.
Black makes holes in pictures, Picasso once said. In a similar vein, Arundhati Roy has written, there are no black cats in the world, only cat-shaped holes in the universe. Bhaskaran's works give us ample grounds for questioning such assertions.
With regard to black, I do not know what Picasso has said about use of black, but to me, every color is my personal choice. As I mentioned earlier, when I taught printmaking at the school, the art school, I had the opportunity of doing lino cuts. Then lino cuts are single color printing. It's a relief printing technique. And I used to roll out black and pull out the beautiful image of white background and black images. I thought that's a beautiful color ever an artist could use, because it's the strongest of all colors. Strongest of color, because if you want to manage a black, you've got to have a lot of other calculations to use black in that load, or if you use black at this level, then you have to compensate with the other colors. And if you're using a simple background of white, it has got to satisfy the requirement of the black load and the white load there. So if you plan it well, you are the master of black also. Now, one Indian artist who took the inspiration from me is Arpana Kaur. Black is a powerful color and I use it equally with other colors also, sometimes black alone, because black itself can be diluted to grays, some silver grays, some whites, and it has a tonal value of its own, and you should play it and to know that you can still handle black as a color. At times I also jump from one to another, as you have asked me. Now, one still life will be strong in colors. The argument is, why should it be so strong? Can we not handle it lighter? Okay, then a lighter one. Why should this man be so formal? Can we make him more a totally abstract man there? Okay, try. So these are self-made arguments within the self, and you try to see the result on your canvases. The ambition is a filmmaker with a large input of services of several other people makes a film. But here, the one man makes his dream come true. And in the process, he may fail or he may be successful. But it's a challenge for him to take up a large white canvas, put his argument, bring it into a product. Muralidharan, one of my students, passed out from the college and I had a big show at Chennai and said, "Sir, would you like to comment on my paintings now?" At this point, I don't have to say anything because both of us are flying in the same sky. The fact is, I've done it, I'm flying, I taught you some nuances of flying and you are flying, let's fly together. So, there is no winner or loser here, we are all in the same plane, trying to fly ourselves, putting our energy and trying to bring in new images. And it's a happy occasion that we see all your students also coming up, like my teachers are seeing me as a prominent artist. Art today sells, and art market is a big boom, and it's the investment opportunity today more than the shares. A cat is a cat, but over the 20-year period, it also changes formats, and more and more freedom is seen in the recent canvases. More and more structural discipline and some containment were there earlier, which is not there anymore, because I know that in any case I'll be successful and they cannot be letting down in the process. So confidence is the most important thing for me. Now I have the confidence that I'll be able to finish a canvas with this argument between the canvas and me, and ultimately I'll say yes, I won, and this is the target. Right now I sometimes bring in my earlier elements of life cycle into the recent work, some of my earlier landscapes into the recent work. I keep on playing because they were all my own creations at one point of time or the other. So playing within this is my freedom. Like a story writer picks up his character from the earlier ones or the recent ones. So it's a process which is going on.